everyone. Welcome to Knowledge is Power. I'm Wanda Miller. I'm the host. This week, I have two guests. Well, one is like the main guest. That's Patrick Keenan next to me. And on his left is Bobby Ann DeLeo, and she is the executive director of the York Literacy Council. And she is back. Well, actually, Literacy Council is representatives back. Because they have this really fun event that they're now, it's a campaign that's going to go to the end of December, is what you said.
December, yeah.
So I'm going to just, before we get into anything else, I'm going to just let her talk about this because it's really fun. we were all having fun with it before the show, and we were tormenting Patrick. And but it's okay because, you know, I know Patrick, so. So I'm going to turn over to you, Bobby, and let you talk a little bit about the ZYX Challenge.
Yes, the ZYX Challenge is a fundraiser and an awareness builder. The fundraiser part is, if you can't say it, pay it, and we hope that you'll visit our website, yorkliteracy.org, or you will hashtag... I'm really bad at that, hashtag ZYX challenge. But the challenge part is to say the alphabet backwards. And Patrick was trying it a little while ago. And I thought, you know, can you give it a shot? Yeah, Patrick?
ZYX WUV.
Darn.
ZYX. W, we got to W
you
because
to
that's
w,
in Wanda.
Yes.
Yeah. V U.
There you go.
T S. Nope.
Okay, so you bring up some really good visuals, and probably you're not even aware that you're doing them, but at the Literacy Council we work with adults. And those adults are trying to learn to read and to write and to do basic math. So they have, when we were in school, we were taught a lot of compensation skills or strategies to be able to remember things. And of course, kids, as you know, with a baby, are like sponges. But as we grow older, it's more difficult to retain information. The challenge for an adult reader, it's a much more difficult process to learn to read for an adult. So when you were saying the alphabet backwards, I could see you kind of looking off to the side because that's one of the memory strategies you know of, to see the alphabet, and you were looking at it to see what was before Z and what was before that W that eluded you. And then there's also things like chunking, so saying it in small parts and then memorizing it, rote learning, doing it over and over again. Well, I couldn't do it a few months ago when we first came up with this challenge, but you're learning, and the more you practice, the more you learn. If you don't continue to practice, you don't continue to learn, or you won't retain it. We have certain number of characters that we can remember in our short-term memory, and then we have, until we can eventually, if we say it enough or look at it enough, we'll be able to put that into long-term memory. So that's what's happening, and that's the awareness portion of the ZYX challenge. So ZYX WVU TSRQPON MLK JIHGFEDCBA. Thank you.
Very good.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, if you notice, I would always get stuck on M. What came after N? Now that's logical. You know, what came after N? I always wanted to go back again, and I thought a strategy that I could use was MLK, milk. Mm-hmm. Okay, so when I get to N, if I don't remember M automatically, I say, oh, milk. MLK. And so I was imploring strategies, but as we get older, those strategies to learn aren't really always there. So a lot of our adults need to be retaught those learning strategies to be able to figure out the printed word. We have a lot of students who are, you know, studying for their GED or to take that high school equivalency diploma. And we have to reteach those study skills and how we chunk things and how we remember different pieces of material. And a lot of it's practice, practice, practice. If you remember back to your times tables, you know, I can clearly remember I went to a Catholic school and we had pages and rows and rows and rows of times tables. That ingrained it in me. Don't ask me what 13 times 2 is, but you can ask me what 12 times 2 is. I got that. I might get 13 times 2 also. Anybody have any questions about that, about the strategy?
What I think is interesting is it's pretty easy to count backwards.
Right.
But it's really when you have to rethink the letters, because when Margot and Joe were here, they got me to do this, and I could do like the last three letters backwards and the first three letters backwards in the middle. You know, it's like, so so I'm going to have to practice this so that I can, you know.
Say it or pay it.
Because you and really, and look, check out all of the really neat little YouTube videos, what we're going to do is Bobby Ann's been nice enough that she's going to send some of these to us so that hopefully to the end of December every week we can show one or two, because a lot of them are really short. And the one that we really want to show is Mayor Bracey. So
she was so gracious.
So Mayor Bracey is going to do this. And,
yes.
And maybe Mayor Bracey would come on and actually do it in person. That'd be kind of fun.
That would be fun.
Yeah.
We'll have to see if her time schedule allows.
Yeah.
That's not up to me.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
We have a video. But, we brought one of those videos today.
Yes, we do. Hey, Ace, can you show that, please?
This is the ZYX Challenge, the York County Literacy Council Board of Directors. Hit it!
ZYXWBUTSRQUEOMMLKJIHG.
F-E-D-C-B-A. The York County Literacy Council urges you to challenge your friends and family to see just how well they can do. And remember, if you can't say it, then pay it. And donate to your local literacy councils.
Okay. Well, that's pretty fun.
Did you see any of the strategies? Did you see them looking into the air?
Yeah.
Those invisible letters?
Yeah.
My favorites are the ones who just sit there and wait for somebody else to say it. Because they haven't learned it yet, so they're not comfortable. And that happens in the classroom, too.
So, Bobby Ann, I have to ask. I couldn't say it, so I have to pay it. How do you go about paying it?
If you go to hashtag ZYXChallenge or go to our website, www.yorkliteracy.org, we'll have a spot for you.
Great.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And good luck with that baby. Now, the baby will be able to say that ZYXChallenge, no problem.
Much quicker than I will. She's doing everything in leaps and bounds. So.
Wonderful. Wonderful.
Well, thank you for all your work you're doing with our older adults that need help learning. That's
great.
Thank
you so very much for having me here. Really appreciate
you. You're welcome. Anytime you want to come back.
We're right up the street.
Yes. You guys do a great job. You give people a wonderful gift. You know, I don't think the majority of us understand how blessed we are to be able to read and have that advantage, because if you can't read, so many doors are closed and so many barriers are put up. So
you are correct.
So you guys do a great job.
Thank you very much.
You're one of the hidden gems of York County. That's what
we're hidden right over there.
Yes, you are right over the United Way building.
That's right. That's right. Well, thank you so very much for
having me. You're welcome.
And good luck to you.
Thank you.
Okay. Am I done?
You're done.
Okay. Whoops. Sorry.
Have a nice holiday.
Okay. You too.
Turkey Day or. Okay, well, that was fun, and I look forward to her sending the the video with Mayor Bracey and other any other officials, or some of them are just really funny that she was nice. So I'm going to be really brief in my little commentary because I really want Patrick to talk about housing as health, and we're going to get into that in a minute. But one thing I do want to say is I am going to give out my Golden Hammer Award this week, and I'm going to give it to Carla Christopher. Because Carla, everyone who knows Carla, she's our local advocate. She's a great leader in the community. Carla's just, I can't say enough about Carla. And I actually texted her before the show and told her, I said, I'm going to do this. And the reason I'm doing it this week is because we have had, with Trump being elected, with Mayor Wasco and all that craziness with the Facebook and the racial tensions and all the other things that are going on, we had the film event on gentrification at the Strand last week, and that was very good, but there were members of the audience who pretty much grandstanded and had very negative things to say about some of the officials. We had Buffalo Shavosky was there, Blonda Nace was there, and you know, all this negativity and all these people are crawling out of the woodwork and calling themselves advocates, and really all I see is pot stirrers. You know, they're going and they're engaging people that have views that we really all don't like. I mean, none of us want to hear that racial slurring crap, but I don't think the way to handle that is to engage somebody and to tell them, you're a horrible person for saying this, you shouldn't say this, because that just sets them up to be more defensive. They come back at you, you go back at them, and nothing gets solved. The way Carla handles things is she actually talks to people. She talks, she listens, she's respectful. She was the one person in the room at the city council meeting with Wasco where there was a young man who stood up and talked about his beliefs in white power and all those other things. And everyone was telling him to shut up, and Carla just quietly said, no, you need to just let him speak, because he has a right to say what he wants to say. It's you know, we have a democracy, we have free speech, and you know, when you try to censor him, then you're just making him right, because he was saying that he doesn't have free speech. So Carla, you know, kudos to you. One of my favorite people. I hope she comes back on the show soon. Her and I need to get together and have lunch again and talk about some things that are happening in the city and the county. So I just want to give you the Golden Hammer. And with that, I'm going to come back over to Patrick. And Patrick Keenan, who is, and I'm going to give his title, even though he said titles don't mean anything. He's the Director of Policy and Consumer Protections for the Pennsylvania Health Access Network. And he's also involved in how did that come to be, that the Housing is Health Coalition, it's an initiative and it's also a campaign.
Sure.
And this is how I got involved with, well, we're going to call it FAN, Pennsylvania Health Access Network. Just from here on out, it's much easier to say that. Patrick spoke at our York County COC back over the summer. I was there, I heard him speak, and one of the things that Patrick and Fan were looking for, and the Housing is Health Coalition was looking for, is they were looking for people to tell their stories about supported housing. So I volunteered because I think it's important, and it's really amazing to me how many people don't step up and tell their stories, that they're embarrassed or they're uncomfortable. So I'm going to just, because I know Patrick is Patrick, so I'm just going to turn it back over to Patrick and let him talk about the Housing is Health Coalition. You know, the challenges of it, what's happening, what it's about, and, you know, you're the expert, so I'm just going to let you talk about that.
Well, Wanda, thank you for having us on today. I mean, I think that we're really happy to be here in York, because York has been overwhelmingly supportive of this, you know, campaign, which is statewide, but it's also something that is really felt in our local communities. Mm-hmm. And so let me back up and talk a little bit about the Pennsylvania Health Access Network first. So the Pennsylvania Health Access Network is a statewide organization that helps folks that, you know, are looking for affordable, high-quality health insurance. We help them sign up for health insurance coverage. We have a statewide helpline and in-person assistance in communities that can help people figure out what their options are. My telephone number is at the bottom of the screen, my direct number. We also have a statewide helpline that's 877-570-3642. But, you know, my direct number can certainly help folks as well, you know, and I'd be happy to connect them with that kind of assistance. Mm-hmm. But, You know, one of the things that we realized as we were helping folks sign up for health insurance coverage is that getting a card in their wallet is often the first step in a journey to becoming healthy, and that when they lack some of the other basic supports, especially housing, you know, it's really difficult to manage your medical conditions. It's difficult if you're diabetic and you don't have a place to store your insulin and you don't have regular shelter. You know, you're not going to be able to adhere to the medicine that's going to keep you healthy and keep you out of the hospital. So what often happens is that folks, you know, end up in the emergency room or worse in a hospital or in a skilled nursing facility because they haven't been able to manage their medical conditions. And this was something that we saw across the state. It wasn't just a city problem. I mean, I think sometimes we think about these things as maybe, you know, York City versus York County. But what we knew was that this was an issue that was happening, you know, both in the city and out in the counties too, because people, you know, when they were, they didn't have, you know, stable housing, they would be bouncing from place to place to place. Mm-hmm. And often in the rural parts of the county, it's harder to get from place to place to place. And you might, you know, leave behind your medicine or other kinds of things and end up in those, that emergency room. So as we saw this problem emerge, we had to look for new solutions. And the reality is that, you know, that other states outside of Pennsylvania are actually doing housing and healthcare a lot better than Pennsylvania is. Mm-hmm. And so we had to start looking around to examples like Texas and Louisiana. Certainly there's bigger states like New York and California, but you know, you really kind of think about something, you know, if Texas and Louisiana can do something, why can't we do it here in Pennsylvania? And the, the clear answer was that there's a way through Medicaid, through Medicaid managed care to actually help people that find themselves without, you know, safe, stable housing, that Medicaid can pay for the assistance they need in looking for an apartment and keeping that, you know, place to live, because it's much cheaper than having them go to the emergency room.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it really is, and this is something that you would think would be common sense. You know, you look at Maslow's hierarchy of needs, mm-hmm. and it's, you know, just use the analogy of a house. A house, you have to have the foundation. If you don't have the foundation, mm-hmm. the house crumbles. So if you don't have that, if you don't have food, if you don't have clothing, if you don't have shelter, if you don't have all those very basic needs, then you're not going to be healthy and prepared enough to go and do other things like get education, get a job, become a productive citizen. So that part is really important to understand. And I think, and the other thing that, and I saw, and I talked to Patrick about this, because last Friday, I attended the gentrification film event at the Strand, and as I said, Blonda Nace was one of the panelists, and someone in the audience was giving him a hard time about how they're not giving enough housing to people that need more affordable housing. There's not enough affordable housing. There's not enough mixed housing. There's not enough this, that, and the other, and I just saw him want to throw his hands in the air, and basically he said to that individual, well, it's the funding. It's the way the government has funding. It ties their hands. So while he would like to provide that, he has to provide what the funding says he can provide. So that's a big issue. And I will say, afterwards, I went up and talked to him for a few minutes. I told him about this campaign, Housing is Health. And he, right away, he said, well, maybe we could collaborate on this. And he was interested in talking to Patrick. So, you know, I guess, you know, kind of the takeaway of this is, yes, we need more affordable housing. Yes, there is a way that we can do this. And Patrick's going to talk mm-hmm. about that. And also, too, when you look at an official, don't just demonize them and make judgments, because you don't know what kind of rules and regulations and hand-tying they have to deal with. So, you know, just kind of keep that in mind as we go forward. So anyway, Patrick, we were talking about the Housing is Health. Now, this is all dependent also on Medicaid being expanded. Is that's correct?
And if I could, I mean, before we touch on that, I think that you brought up a really important point, and that is that, you know, there's this hierarchy of needs and people need basic needs met. Mm-hmm. Well, we see, you know, I mean, often people that might be looking at this idea of housing as health, you know, might say, what does that have any, I mean, they get the idea that someone needs a place to put their insulin or, you know, a place to keep their medicine for high blood pressure. But they say, well, isn't that a stretch, right? You know, I mean, isn't that, you know, overstepping, you know, healthcare can only do so much, then we need to rely on housing. And I think that one thing, one concept I want to kind of put out there to folks is called the social determinants of health. So what we know by evidence is we know that there's a lot of different factors that impact our healthcare. And what our doctor can do for us, what the medical professionals that care for us can do, is actually a really tiny percentage of the overall, you know, kinds of overall success mm-hmm. of our health. So a doctor, you know, and their abilities and our healthcare providers can really provide for like 20 or 30% of our overall healthcare. Mm-hmm. Another, you know, 10 to 20% is determined by our genetics, by our family, by our medical history. But that, you know, overwhelming majority of our healthcare is actually controlled by other things, by environmental factors, like, you know, do we have safe, stable, supportive housing? Do we have access to healthy foods? Do we, you know, live in a community that, you know, is free of violence and we're not going to experience, death by guns or, you know, other kinds of mm-hmm. things, right? So I think that it's really important for folks to understand that, you know, as a healthcare, housing is a really important healthcare intervention, because without housing, a doctor can only do so much, and even if we have the best genetic makeup and the best family history, you know, we can really only go so far. And housing takes, you know, although it might be a small percentage of the population that lacks safe, stable housing, you know, it's a percentage of the population that can cost a lot of money in our healthcare system mm-hmm. if we don't get them connected to that safe, stable housing, because they're bouncing in and out of the emergency room and going to the hospital frequently.
Mm-hmm. And I actually was lucky enough to attend the FAN Health Conference back in September. And one of the speakers, it was Patrick facilitated, and it was like the last session, I mm-hmm. think. And it was Jonathan McVeigh.
Yep. McVeigh.
He is with the PA Department of Human Services. And, you know, one of the things that he talked about, and I talked to him after he had done his presentation, and we talked about this issue. And he said, you know, when you think about older adults, too, this is so much more cost-effective than putting them in nursing homes. Mm-hmm. It's so much better for them than putting them in nursing homes. And his comment to me was, you know, what they're really looking to do is contain costs, because they can see within the coming years, as the population grays in Pennsylvania, mm-hmm. there's going to be more and more costs. So they need to start intervening now and doing things that, you know, starting to look at some alternative solutions to this that don't rely on, we'll just put people in nursing homes, or we'll just, you know, let them on the streets, or we'll, you know, we'll have them in housing that costs like 90% of their income, which, you know, how long can they stay in housing that costs 90% of their income? And that really that's a stat. I saw that in several housing conferences.
People are really, I mean, I think that the reality is people really are burdened by the cost of healthcare and also burdened by the cost of housing. And so when they struggle with one, they're going to struggle with the other. Mm-hmm. And the state, you know, under Jonathan McVeigh and Ben Loudermilk, who work for the State Department of Human Services, they've really led a lot of the efforts to make sure that Pennsylvania is examining all the ways in which people that are on Medicaid or, you know, Medicare, you know, that they can, bring those two things together with housing and health. So the state's done a huge amount of work internally, and we as the Housing as Health campaign have also done quite a bit of work. So, you know, often our efforts have been complementing each other, but we as a campaign, you know, I think the first thing to really kind of clear up is that the Housing as Health campaign is trying to win supportive housing services paid for through Medicaid dollars. This is something that the federal government has said would be, possibly permitted for the states to do, and it's not something that Pennsylvania currently does. So we want to see that happen, and I think that we should start probably with what are supportive housing services. Mm-hmm. So basically, you know, people that are on the streets that are chronically homeless, you know, often have trouble navigating the system. They might not have all the documents that they need to complete a rental application. Mm-hmm. They might, you know, not, as we saw earlier from the literacy challenge, they might not even be able to read the forms or understand how to kind of find a place to live, right? So, you know, so those are one bucket of services of helping folks navigate and find housing and apply for and be accepted into housing, right, and navigate the programs that can help them pay for that. But then secondly, you know, if you've been on the streets or in unstable situations, you might have a difficult time adjusting to housing. You might not have all the things you need to kind of make that housing your home, right? Or you may find yourself in uncomfortable situations with a landlord or other tenants. And so, you know, often what we know is that, you know, when someone kind of transitions from an unstable situation to housing, they need some help. They need someone to intervene. They need someone to talk to the landlord. They need someone to just ask questions about what they need to do so that they can kind of keep that housing. So those are the kinds of services that we're talking about when we're talking about supportive housing services. And we know that people in supportive housing, we know a couple of things. We know that they're more likely, first of all, to stay in that housing. Mm-hmm. But we also know that they're less likely to use more expensive kinds of healthcare. So, you know, once they get housing, they're more likely to go to their primary care doctor. They're more likely to follow up on the recommendations that the doctor makes for tests or other kinds of things. And so they're not going to the emergency room. They're not going, you know, into the hospital as much. They're not having to stay in the hospital or be admitted into a nursing home. So they're actually, you know, able to, you know, to with these services, they're able to kind of keep in that housing, so they're not bouncing from place to place, which is really expensive for York County and all the other counties across the state. And they're not, you know, utilizing those really expensive places to get, you know, healthcare. They're going to the more affordable and better places to get their care.
And people that watch the show know that I am receiving supportive housing services through Bell Socialization. It's, you know, I'm very open about that, and I'm not ashamed of it. And I don't think, you know, anyone should be ashamed of, you know, you had a situation and that's what it is. But I will say that in my situation, the case manager for a building, her name is Isabel Smith. I'm going to give her a shout out because she's a great person. And Isabel's job, and actually all the case managers that manage the buildings, their job is to make sure that people can stay in their housing. Now, the strange thing about that is there is no requirement that says any of the tenants have to meet with them at any time. There's no, like, we don't have to meet with them once a month, or we'd never have to see them. But I will say that those of us who take advantage of that, and we do keep in touch with our case manager, and just even with me, because I, you know, I'm pretty functional, but I still meet with her at least once a month, and we go out to lunch or something, we just talk about and see how everything's going, everything is okay. And those of us that do that and have a good working relationship, a professional relationship with our case manager, those are the ones that tend not to go back into the hospital. Those are the ones, so that's, I think, right in itself, that is a testimony to the power of supportive housing services. They work if the person's willing to work at it. So if the person's willing to accept those services, they're much less likely to go back inpatient, which is a huge cost saver, a huge cost saver.
And what we need to think about is just, I mean, you know, those, you know, when people are bouncing from place to place to place, you know, and in and out of the ER and in and out of housing, you know, that's really hard on programs like Bell. It's hard on, you know, the hospitals. You know, and we can do better than that. I think that what we realize, you know, as a statewide coalition, we've got over 90 organizations that have signed on to the Housing as Health campaign. And if anyone's interested, you can go to housingashealth.org and find, you know, a list of those organizations as well as a wealth of information about supportive services. Mm-hmm. But what we find is that, you know, we're really looking for common sense solutions to some of the biggest problems that we have. To guide us in that work, I mean, I think that, you know, we've been working, as you mentioned, with Jonathan and Ben, you know, at the state, and we've kind of been in a parallel process. We As a campaign commissioned the Corporation for Supportive Housing, so a national think tank, you know, folks that have got lots of degrees and kind of think these things out, for us to really look and to dig into Pennsylvania's Medicaid program, because we felt like if we're going to advocate for something, that we need to really know what it is that we're advocating for and what some of the barriers, you know, are that you know, we might have. And so they did it was a lot of work. It was called a Medicaid crosswalk, but it boils down into five simple recommendations. Mm-hmm. The first is that, you know, we need common sense definitions for what these supportive housing services are, and we need to make sure that there's consistency, because I think that anyone that's ever, you know, interacted with the government might know that, you know, one program has one set of definitions and another program has another set of definitions, and it can be confusing for both the people that, you know, have to implement those programs and the people receiving services. So the first thing that we said is we really just need to get you know, folks from all across the state to work with the state to come up with one set of definitions that works for different populations. The second thing is that we know that a lot of people are left out. So right now, to get supportive housing in Pennsylvania, there are opportunities to do it, but often you have to have a serious mental illness. Mm-hmm. What does that mean? Schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, you know, things that are really you know, challenging, and folks really do need that intervention, but it means that a whole bunch of people are left out. I think that Pennsylvania has been really hit hard by substance use disorder. You know, we see this with opioid addiction and just you know, kind of people turning to alcohol and other drugs, you know, to kind of alleviate some of the problems that they're having. And right now, folks with substance use disorder don't get covered with supportive housing. So they can get into treatment, they can get into recovery, but unless they have a family member that they can live with or a program to be discharged to, often, you know, they could find themselves, after doing all of that good work, you know, right back on the streets. Mm-hmm. And we also know that folks with physical health conditions, you know, there are simply folks that are homeless and living on the streets, but they have, you know, how many people don't have, you know, high blood pressure, right, diabetes, you know, these kind of common things, and you know, you can take, you know, the medicine and those pills, but you need a place to be able to do that. So we need to include, you know, we need to get a set of definitions together, and we need to make sure that, you know, all the folks that are struggling with housing are included in those definitions. And the other thing is that, you know, to programs like Bell, we need the state to work with, you know, the managed care companies, the insurance companies, mm-hmm, that provide Medicaid insurance, and we need those managed care companies to work with programs like Bell so that they can actually do this. Mm-hmm. Because this could be a great idea, but if we don't implement it really well, if we don't work with Bell Socializations and the other kinds of community-based providers, it's never actually going to hit, mm-hmm, the ground. So those were, you know, just three of the recommendations that the Corporation for Supportive Housing kind of came up with. And so, you know, in that, we've kind of made that the framework of our campaign, the Housing is Health campaign, to make sure we get consistent definitions, to make sure that we include the people that really could benefit from these services, and to make sure that our community providers understand these changes if we're successful in them, mm-hmm, and can actually start delivering the services right here in York.
Yeah, and it, you know, you just keep going back, and we worry about the human factor, but even the cost effectiveness is so much higher when you're looking at supportive housing, as what you're saying about, and I'm going to, please, add on to this, because this is what you said last week at the, mm-hmm, at the housing conference, and it's a good point that when basically what happened to myself when I first got illegally evicted and was homeless, and I was at the CDR, local CDR, it's not no longer open, but I didn't qualify for any of these things because, mm-hmm, I didn't have that severe and pervasive mental illness. Mm-hmm. It took me 3 inpatient stays and being homeless for approximately, let's say, from August to like December of 2012, till somebody finally said, it was a psychiatrist that finally said, you know, well, you need housing. You need, right, housing, that's what you need. But they couldn't get me housing because I didn't qualify. So a lot of times, as you made the point last week, people get misdiagnosed so that they can get the housing, because maybe, right, they don't really have that, you know, like I have PTSD. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, because PTSD can also look like other disorders, And I'm not saying that they're cheating the system, but when you're trying to get someone housed, and it's that, you know, you don't want that person on the street. Mm-hmm. You know, so what choice do they have? You know, so that sets up a whole other issue with people being misdiagnosed, taking unnecessary meds. This way, they wouldn't have to go through all that. It would give the people that are trying to place homeless individuals much more leeway as to who they can place, rather than have to turn people away because, well, you're not sick enough yet.
Right.
So put you out, let you get sicker, and then we'll come back to us.
And that's the thing, is that when people do get sicker, you know, and we know that they will, you know, if they have an untreated condition, you know, and they don't have housing, they will get sicker, and that's going to cost us more money, you know. And I think that time and time again, we kind of hear, you know, there's these two competing elements of, you know, do we do good things for people just because they're good things to do, or do we do things because there's money behind it? And the, what I think is the no-brainer behind supportive housing services is that we can actually do both. Mm-hmm. What we learned, you know, is that as a campaign, we started to look at this problem in Pennsylvania, and we learned that if we provided supportive housing services to only a small percentage of folks, you know, we looked at roughly 1,300 individuals. Mm-hmm. What we learned is that, you know, and those are individuals that, you know, are costing the healthcare system a lot of money, right? You know, they're in the top 10% of utilizers. But we learned that if we provided them with supportive housing services, if we were able to get them into housing, and provide this benefit, and this benefit costs money, mm-hmm. right? But we would actually end up as a state saving $1.47 million. So not only are we doing the right thing by getting people into housing that need it, but even after we've paid for the additional cost of that service, you know, of that benefit, we actually still end up saving money because they're not going to those expensive places. So mm-hmm. it doesn't always have to be a trade-off between people or dollars. This is one of those things that actually makes sense where the two go hand in hand. You can do the right thing for people, the ethical thing to get them connected to housing, but you can also save money by doing. And I think that that's a really important thing in this budget climate. I mean, we've learned that, you know, a short distance down the road in Harrisburg, you know, I mean, money is on everyone's mind, and we're trying to fund our schools and run social programs and make sure that people, you know, don't have really high tax bills at the same time. So this is one of those opportunities that we have to really be able to do the right thing for people, provide an additional service, but also still continue to save money for the state.
Yeah, and you never know what that person... You know, you look at that person and you think that person has some kind of, you know, a horrible mental illness, and, well, we're just going to put him in the, these are for the naysayers out there, you know, we'll just put him in housing and they'll suck off the system. But you don't, that's a judgment, because you don't know what that person's capable of. You know, there are people, I'm college educated and I'm in supported housing. And, you know, it's a long journey back to mainstream life mm-hmm. for a lot of people. So you can't just blanket that judgment over everyone and say, well, you know, they're just sucking off the system, because, you know, 9 times out of 10, you know, there are people that take advantage. I'm not going to say there aren't, but 9 times out of 10, people really need to be there. They need that help. And they can't, just like the woman from the Literacy Council, like, if you don't know how to read, if you need all these basic skills, how do you expect someone to become successful and become a contributing member of society if they're not healthy?
Right.
If they don't have that housing, if they don't have that stability, because just the instability alone of not knowing, where am I going to sleep tonight? Am I going to be safe? Am mm-hmm. I going to? Thank God I never had to be on the streets, but I know people who did have to be on the streets. I know people that slept under porches.
Sure.
And under the bridge, and they were scared because they had a right to be scared, because they would get beat up. You know, women get raped. Mm-hmm. Those things happen. And then you have... Then, okay, so because you didn't provide housing for that person, now you have a situation where someone got beat up, now they have trauma, now they have more issues, that's going to compound into more issues, and it's just going to escalate until, you know, you have somebody like myself going into an inpatient facility for $30,000 for right. a 30-day stay, because it's $1,000 a day, and that's all in taxpayers' dime. So...
You can either pay now or you can pay later.
Exactly.
You know, and I mean, the cost, what we realize is, you know, supportive housing services, the cost is so small, compared to some of those bigger costs that mm-hmm. we would have to pay, you know, later on if we didn't do this. And I think that, you know, the other thing to kind of think about, because some in the audience may say, well, I don't know anyone who's homeless, you know, right? And that could be a fair thing, you know, maybe people are, you know, and their families or their communities very lucky to not know a homeless person, but they certainly know someone that's aging, you know, and struggling with trying mm-hmm. to possibly keep their home, right? And so, you know, right now, I mean, the idea is that, or you know, maybe their, you know, husband or wife, you know, died and they've been living alone in a house and it's been really hard to keep up and there's no one kind of like, you know, checking to make sure that, you know, it's still safe and supportive housing, you know. And so what this does is actually, you know, it helps us, you know, provide those small additional supports that, you know, folks that have been on the streets or our seniors, you know, who are struggling with things, or folks that have been, you know, who are coming out of recovery, you know, we want them to return to the community. We want them mm-hmm. to be in the community, and we want them to help be, you know, productive members of the community. And, you know, these are those little services that we can pay for to make that possible.
Yeah, and if you think about with the aging population, okay, you know, I have someone who's older, and they're trying to hold on to their house, and maybe, you know, they're not really able to hold on to their house and they refuse to leave. Well, the Older Adult Protective Services Act allows the area and agents to go in and take that person out. So the person doesn't want to leave, but okay, you're going to make the person go. Well, then that sets up a whole dynamic of now they can't just take the person out. They have to have a hearing to declare them incapacitated. Mm-hmm. So that costs money. Those hearings are not cheap. And then they place them in a nursing home, and the nursing homes are like $7,000 a month, some, you know, generally, right. Before, and all this time, if the person doesn't already have medical assistance, which many seniors who are living by themselves don't, because they have too many assets, so now they have to get all those assets spent down quickly, mm-hmm. which the nursing home is very happy to help them with, but... You have a situation where the person's going in there and they're not automatically on medical assistance, and so there's a lot of money going into the nursing homes, going into legal services for older adults that are being under protective services, and that is a big issue. And housing is so much. Whereas if you could go to someone and say, you know, okay, I know you like your house, but here we have supported housing for you. Mm-hmm. We can give you these supports. We can get you a medical. I mean, sure, it's still going to be somewhat traumatic, but it's so much nicer and kinder, I think, than forcing someone, because then the person can make the decision. The person has a say in the decision.
And part of the state's plan is actually to you know, what it knows, you know, being the State Department of Human Services, they know that mm-hmm. people prefer to live mm-hmm. in the community that, you know, that they've lived in all their lives. And often they prefer to even live in their own home. And where it's possible, part of what the state housing strategy, you know, will attempt to kind of tackle is for those, you know, who are eligible for medical assistance, you know, it will help them kind of make the modifications that they might need mm-hmm. to stay in their own home, to avoid going to a nursing home, you know, possibly connect them to a different housing unit if their home isn't the appropriate place to be, but to give them more freedom to kind of be in that place, you know, where they're, mm-hmm. where they're comfortable. Because we know that alone, I mean, I think if we only took a small percentage of people that are inappropriate placed in nursing homes out of those nursing homes and return them back to the community, the state could save millions of dollars. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's, you know, I mean, that's not, you know, there's some really dramatic statistics that if we could do this and do this well, everyone benefits, because mm-hmm. then, you know, seniors are in their preferred place to live, and it's costing the state a lot less in terms of money.
Yeah, I don't know what the current stat is, but I know that it, you know, this wasn't too long ago, it was about half of what it costs to keep someone in a nursing home.
That's exactly correct.
To keep someone yeah. in their home. So for every one person that goes into a nursing home, you could keep two people at home.
Exactly. So, no, it's a no-brainer. You know, I think the one thing that it's important to kind of talk about right now, and you kind of brought this up earlier, though, is the fact that, you know, all of this is done. Pennsylvania has had a huge influx of money from the federal government under a really popular program called Medicaid Expansion. So mm-hmm. Previously, before the Affordable Care Act was passed, you know, we had, you know, situations where folks either had to be elderly and, you know, have really low income, or they had to be a pregnant woman, or, you know, a child, or someone who was, you know, determined by Social Security to be disabled. And, you know, those were the only folks that could get Medicaid, right? But what we know is that there are a lot of folks, you know, across the Commonwealth, you know, that are working, you know, often really hard jobs, low-wage jobs. Mm-hmm. You know, these are people that are actually working in nursing homes, caring for our elderly mm-hmm. individuals. They're working in restaurants and all kinds of service industry jobs that don't have health care. And yet they're working really hard, but not enough to kind of, they don't get health care from their employer and they can't afford it, you know, in other ways. So Pennsylvania took a really bold step, you know, in 2015 and expanded its Medicaid program, which has been a really popular thing. 671,000 folks are now covered under that Medicaid expansion. I'm sorry to say off the top of my head, I don't remember. I just redid the numbers for York County, and I don't remember how many are right here okay. in York. I can possibly pull that up. But I mean, I think that the important thing to know is that, you know, Medicaid, you know, has done a couple of things, this Medicaid expansion. Mm-hmm. One, it's allowed people that, you know, previously couldn't see the doctor or couldn't get preventative care, you know, they can now go to the doctor and you know, catch a cancer diagnosis before mm-hmm. it happens. You know, I was working, I've done, besides, you know, my official role at FAN, I often, you know, in the past couple of years have been fortunate to kind of sit down with folks and help them enroll. And, you know, there was one prominent story, you know, in Lancaster County that we encountered of someone who, you know, had gone without health care, you know, for 15 years. He was working as a bus driver. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he was, I mean, these are the people that keep our kids safe mm-hmm. on the roads, right? And, you know, he was, you know, he was working, it's not easy hours, and, you know, you have a lot of responsibility. Mm-hmm. And he hadn't had health care for 15 years. We were able to get him signed up under Medicaid expansion. First time he went to the doctor, you know, we followed up with him and said, you know, how did it go? And he said, I'm going in next week for surgery. And we said, why? He had, you know, three of his main arteries blocked to where he was, you know, days, weeks, months away from having a heart attack. Yeah. You know, and so you kind of think about mm-hmm. this situation and, you know, I mean, it was really, it was a life-saving thing. I mean, he was able to kind of get, you know, the simple stents that he needed to put in and get the medication. Mm-hmm. So much more cost effective than, you know, God forbid him having a heart attack, you know, and possibly putting the lives of children in danger. So Medicaid expansion has done a really good thing for a lot of hardworking mm-hmm. folks. But I think that what, you know, what we're concerned about is that it's something that could possibly, you know, if folks don't kind of stand up and start thinking about this, could possibly go away, you know, in 2 years from now, because there's new, you know, the majority of folks in Congress right now are kind of thinking about ways in which they could actually get rid of that Medicaid expansion. Mm-hmm. So I think that's really important to kind of point out, because all of these good ideas with supportive housing and just getting folks the basic access to health care that they need, right now they're under attack.
Mm-hmm. And it's important to remember that. And just piggybacking off what you're saying about that gentleman, I have a dear friend, and pretty much the same thing happened with her, and I had heard before she had her issues, she had had issues with her stomach. She had had gastrointestinal discomfort and other issues. They couldn't find anything. And finally, she ended up in the hospital for nearly a month with Crohn's disease. Mm-hmm. And it was one of those situations where, as you said, if she had had these preventative measures, these preventative care available to her years before this, probably wouldn't have gotten to that point. So this is where we're going to shift from it not only being cost effective, but being a lifesaver for people that you know and love. Because, you know, who knows if this goes away, which, you know, we're hoping that it doesn't go away, and we're hoping that the powers that be and this is the time in January when things roll over to new Congress and Senate and President and everything. This is, if you, you know, if you feel strongly about this, this is where your voice can really be heard. And to just start talking out and speaking out about it and saying you don't want these cuts to happen.
So I gave you, I mean, so, and again, anyone that's interested in these kinds of things, mm-hmm. I gave you, I mean, I think my number is on the telephone screen. And I will say this, you know, I'll try to get to folks, you know, as quickly as we can. You know, there's, we have our website for the Housing as Health campaign. So if folks are interested in that, again, it's housingashealth.org. You can also call me and I can make sure you get connected with those resources. But the other thing is for folks that believe, you know, in healthcare coverage, and I know that there's good groups, you know, here in York County. You mentioned Carla, who's kind of, you know, been on the forefront of a lot mm-hmm. of this healthcare stuff. So that's great. You know, we really need a statewide movement right now of folks speaking up and speaking out about healthcare as a fundamental human right, and not just healthcare in general, but affordable, high quality, and equitable healthcare that everyone can access. And right now, I mean, I think the scary thing is that we, you know, there's. We recently, you know, had elections, and you know, one of the promises made, you know, by the powers that be is that they are going to kind of take away the Affordable Care Act, right? Mm-hmm. Which is allowed for the Medicaid expansion and other things to happen, and they've been doing that because, you know, we do hear a lot of folks that say, you know, okay, the Affordable Care Act just hasn't been affordable for me. Mm-hmm. And I think that what we need to do, rather than repeal it, is we need to actually strengthen the law and make mm-hmm. it better. You know, we need to find a bipartisan, workable solution to bring the cost of healthcare down. But it doesn't mean that we have to get rid of coverage for 671,000 Pennsylvanians, or overall the 1.1 million Pennsylvanians that mm-hmm. gained healthcare under the Affordable Care Act. We can't go back into a time where 1.1 million Pennsylvanians are simply mm-hmm. out of luck and in the dark and living with the fear of that, you know, comes from being uninsured. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, in addition to the Housing as Health campaign, we're also, you know, we're very busy right now. We launched what's called insurepa.org, insurepa.org. And again, I know that that's a lot to kind of remember, so folks can always, you know, call me if they're looking for more information, and I can if they leave a number, I can make sure that one of our folks gets back in contact with them. Mm-hmm. But InsurePA is about, you know, folks speaking up for affordable, high quality, equitable healthcare, and making sure that we keep the consumer protections. Before the Affordable Care Act, folks with pre-existing conditions, you know, I think there's a statistic like, you know, basically half of Pennsylvanians have a pre-existing condition. And before the Affordable Care Act, you know, those folks were, you know, either unable to be insured or faced really, really high costs. Women, non-smoking women, before the Affordable Care Act, paid more, almost nearly double, for their health insurance than smoking men. You know, because women use more healthcare. They sometimes mm-hmm. I always say women are smarter than men. They go to the yeah. doctor, right? you know, so we have all these consumer protections that are kind of put in place by the Affordable Care Act. We have the Medicaid expansion for really hardworking folks that, you know, don't get coverage, you know, through a job or can't afford coverage. Right now we have subsidies, you know, for some folks in the marketplace. And, you know, we just need to make it better, and we need folks to kind of stand up and speak out about what the Affordable Care Act has done. Because the reality is it could be as early as February that we start reading headlines about the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare being repealed. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the reality of that is that, you know, again, would leave 1.1 million Pennsylvanians without a coverage option. Now, it might take some time for them to repeal that, but again, you know, if we don't say, if we as a community here in York County don't stand up and speak out about this, mm-hmm. then it can happen, you know, mm-hmm. And it can happen quite quickly because it's been a big campaign promise. So I want to kind of just put that message out there to mm-hmm. folks that, you know, if you believe in affordable, high quality healthcare, we really need you, you know, to speak up. You know, even if you're a senior and you say the ACA, you know, hasn't really, you know, allowed me to get coverage, I'm on Medicare. The Affordable Care Act has great advantages for seniors in there. It's actually extended the life of the Medicare program. You know, before the ACA, Medicare was going to go bankrupt by 2017, next year, like 2 months away from now. And now the newest figures say, you know, Medicare has enough money to kind of keep it operating until I think it's 2024, you know, which is still pretty close. But I mean, you know, that's a huge, you know, we've seen in just 3 or 4 years of the Affordable Care Act being around, we've seen it add a lot of years, extra years to the Medicare program. So my telephone number is, I think, on the bottom of the screen. I'm happy to kind of, you know, help folks kind of understand what we're doing with InsurePA or the Housing as Health campaign. And we're really, you know, thankful for you giving us this opportunity to kind of talk about both of these things.
Yeah, I'm glad you're here. And then one thing that I have, and I don't, you know, don't quote me on this because I haven't checked it out, but I have heard from various people that President-elect Donald Trump has a website out there and he wants feedback from the American people. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if that's true, like I said, I haven't looked up the website or anything, but if that's true, there's a great opportunity to get on there. And, you know, if you're a believer in the Affordable Care Act, which I don't know why you wouldn't be, because of course, you know, there's always some issues and there could be some tweaks here and there. But again, you know, there's people that you know and you love and even yourself that, you know, if you don't have medical insurance, you don't get that care, then what happens? So I think that's important. It's really important.
What we need to really understand, and I think, you know, as a closing note, and I would say, you know, first of all, no one law could have fixed the entire healthcare system. Mm-hmm. I mean, we had a broken system that had locked people out of healthcare and getting the services they need for many years. You know, the Affordable Care Act, while it's delivered and really life-saving and important coverage to many people, there's still lots of things that could be done. We could lower prescription drug costs. We could, you know, work at containing healthcare costs. You know, there's lots of important ideas, but we want to make sure that anything that happens in Washington doesn't leave 1.1 million Pennsylvanians in the dark and return them to not having coverage or a situation where they can't afford coverage because they have a pre-existing condition or, you know, the paperwork isn't right, you know? And so I think that that's the key message is that, you know, let's work. And if, you know, anyone is talking about repealing the Affordable Care Act, they better have a really solid plan, a clearly laid out plan that everyone can read for what they're going to do to replace that. Mm-hmm. Because otherwise, you know, we're really talking about a disaster. With folks losing really important and life-saving healthcare coverage. Mm-hmm.
And we have a few minutes yet, Patrick, and in the few minutes that we have remain, I want to thank you, first of all, for coming on, and I come back anytime. And
thank you.
And, you know, Patrick, I joke that I'm the unofficial mascot of FAN because I've been going and talking about supported housing. But one thing I do want to mention as closing is that Pennsylvania Health Access Network needs stories about people. They want stories. They want stories of your experience with health care, with supported housing. Is Robin Stelly still?
Absolutely.
This still.
I was just on the phone with her before I got here, so yes.
Okay.
So, I mean, so I just want to mention, you know, you're exactly right. We've always been a consumer-driven organization. We're not. Sometimes people hear of us and think that we're some big statewide entity. I mean, we do a lot of things across the state, but with a really small staff that's dedicated and passionate about this. And the most important thing is that we're standing up and standing on the side of healthcare consumers because they need a voice in Harrisburg and they need, you know, that voice to be heard clearly. And so whatever resources we have local consumer protection committees and a statewide one that are, you know, average everyday consumers that are speaking up and speaking out about the need for high quality, affordable healthcare coverage. And so, you know, I encourage you, if you're interested in that, please, my telephone number is at the bottom of the screen. Please give me a call. I'm happy to get, you know, I know that you got connected with Robin and that's how you attended our statewide conference and you've been a mascot. We need more mascots. We need more people speaking up and speaking out because at the end of the day, you know, healthcare really should be a human right for all people. So
yeah, and I couldn't have ended that more perfectly. And Ace is over there giving me the hand signals. So I'm going to close it there and thank Patrick again for coming. And next week we won't be on the air because it's Thanksgiving, it's Turkey Day. And I don't know about you, but I need a break. And Ace is having family coming, so he's going to be stuffing himself with turkey. And he, you know, if we had the show, he'd probably just be over there going, from all the tryptophans. So... So I think,
Wanda,
you know,
thank you for having us.
You're welcome.
And we appreciate it.
Yeah, you're saying so. Yeah, Ace is counting us down. So anyway, have a good holiday, and we'll see you after next week. Bye.
Hi folks, I'm Steve Butler. I'm really excited about today's project. It's the perfect recycle, reuse, repurpose project. We're gonna take this simple cigar box and turn it into a cigar box guitar here in the garage. Other than tinkering around in the garage.